Yeah, thank you, sir. It's wonderful to be with you in this very, very interesting and important instruction course. As we know, posterior polar cataracts do have its own associated surgical problems with surgeons, and patients will have some sort of doubt, and they might consult many surgeons before they opt for surgery in some cases. Just to show a video how we tackle these cases of posterior polar cataract. It is beyond imagination to say that examination of these cases are very, very critical by good slit lamp assessment of hardness of nucleus, the posterior capsular integrity and size of disc and thickness of disc is also very, very important. In cases of pre-existing posterior capsular dehiscence, you have to look into the anterior vitreous face also. In total cataract, sometimes you may have to do a UBM to see what is behind the posterior capsular area. The rexus has to be well sized, around 5 millimeter is a good size rexus for these patients. I normally don't engage into an oval size rexus for these cases. I think central rexus is a desirable size for these patients. And conventionally, we avoid hydrodissection all these cases. Decrease the pressure, remove viscoelastic. This is one hydrodelineation you can see here. And we'll do another hydrodelineation. So we have two rings of hydrodelineation and that will safeguard us from the posterior capsule. So we have a cushion of epicortex, which will maintain the integrity of a complex till the end of surgery. Subsequently, surgery becomes very simple. You have a moderate parameter, moderate IOP, moderate aspiration flow rate and vacuum. And most of the time it is a zero phaco procedure. You have to do a central sculpting to get into the core of a first core of a nucleus. Then subsequently we can take out the entire core layer by layer. So this is a layer by layer phaco which we are doing here. And subsequently remove the central area. See this nucleus is mobile, but epicortex is still attached. That is how it's going to save. Now we are going to take out the first layer of epicortex. This is a primary layer of epicortex which comes out quite smoothly. So we'll be left with the epicortex and cortical cushion subsequently. And that has to be taken very diligently because you still may have a posterior capsule attached to the entire complex. So we'll just take out the periphery part of epicortex, make sure that we don't come to the center. So this is what we'll do, take out the central area. Now we'll go to periphery, pull out this little bit from all sides. So this will allow the internal hydrodissection to happen at this stage. Because now we have taken on the entire nucleus. Even you have a posterior capsular dehiscence, so you can still manage this case without a serious complication. So you can see we are, to the end of surgery, we have removed the entire block of epicortex and leave the entire clean posterior capsule subsequently, and you can put any desirable IOL subsequently. In these cases, you have signed off a posterior capsular disc defect. This is recently we described in JCRS. And once you see this disc defect, which normally occurs towards the end of your procedure, or it may be towards after a nucleotomy or after epicortical cushion removal, sometimes you have a complete disc, sometimes you have an incomplete disc, and almost 87% of cases, you'll see this clear disc. And that's an indication of safety for your patient. Around 9 eyes of around 80 patients, we didn't see the disc. In those cases, we had either complete adhesion of a posterior complex of this polar cataract to the posterior. You can see this stress line coming to the posterior capsule. So this indicates that this would have a dehiscence of posterior capsule. You have to be very, very careful. You can see the elliptical tear coming up in these cases. In 9 cases, we didn't have this disc defect sign. And of that, 3 patients had a posterior capsular dehiscence in these cases. So if you can see this disc defect, it is a sign that you are in a safe hands. Just to show a similar case, this is a type 2 polar cataract as per OCT classification. I'll just go to the last stage of surgery after we remove the nucleus here. I'm towards the epicortical removal now. You can see the entire epicortex can be seen in the OCT here. And just see how it goes. Once you remove the thick epicortex, you'll see the defect coming up now. This is a disc defect in the epicortical cushion or a cortical disc defect. Once you see this, you are pretty safe that your capsule will be intact and don't have to worry. You can see that posterior capsule is rightly intact and you can use any type of IOL. In fact, this patient, we could put the lens very, very effectively as such. I think there is a role of OCT assessment in pre-op, like anti-segment OCT or a good microscopic examination. If you have IOCT attached microscope, that will give much more information. This is our classification, three types of posterior polar cataract, except for open posterior capsule here. The type one where you have a very nice disc seen and the central capsule can also be visualized apart from the disc. Type two, central area is not visible, but periphery you can still delineate the posterior capsule apart from the disc size which can be seen here. Type three, the one which is difficult where you can't see the entire length of a posterior capsule from the disc. And these cases may have more chances of posterior capsule adhesions happening. So this is a type three variety of a posterior polar cataract. And we have seen that these cases also have a slightly denser nucleus. So denser the nucleus, larger the disc, will have more chances of complex getting adherent to the posterior capsule and will have more chances of rupturing in the process. So we do hydro delineation only, we don't do hydro dissection. You can see after nucleus removal, entire disc is attached and central area may also be attached to the posterior capsule. So these cases will have more chances of posterior capsule opening up. So type two, type three, we do have a certain chance of a capsular rupture happening. Type one, where you can delineate the entire posterior capsule, which may be sometimes can be classified as a posterior subcapsular looking like a posterior polar. Their chances of rupture is very minimal. Same thing can be assessed in a OCT, which you see in a femtosecond devices. Dr. Mahipal has nicely described this OCT picturization to identify the ruptured or open posterior capsule. This picture can give you all the details and accordingly you can manage these cases. You can make a safety of rings or you make a combination of chop and safety, and that makes things easier. I would say if you have a good examination and if you have OCT assessment, you can delineate the type one from the type two, type three. Type one, you can do hydro dissection and surgery becomes very simple, fast, without damaging the posterior capsule. Type two and three, where you have a posterior capsule cannot be delineated. The size is more than 4 millimeter. Those cases, you should avoid hydro dissection, do a delineation, complete your nucleotomy, and pull the epicortex slowly from periphery towards the center. Don't take out completely. Wait for an internal delineation dissection to happen. Subsequently, you can remove in block the entire epicortical cushion. To summarize, posterior polar, the chances of rupture is quite less now with understanding of entire morphology and dynamics. Slow motion phaco with whatever machine you are used to should be done. Hydro dissection, yes, for a delineated posterior capsule, clearly with your examination. Avoid in type 2, type 3, and type 4 with a capsule already open. OCT may help you deciding what step you have to do. IOCT might prevent you doing a hydro dissection in some cases. But IOCT per se may not prevent the incidence of PCR happening in cases of type 3 and type 4. Femtosecond, yes, it is a good tool where we know that it's going to help in a difficult situation like posterior polar cataract. And thank you, sir, for getting me into this course. And it was wonderful to be associated with you.